Why do we do baby dedication? Some people say, well, we don't baptize our children, so we have to do something. I think that's a little unfair. Jesus said, allow the children to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. Well, when you look at little children sometimes today, they look pretty nice. There are other times you kind of wonder, you know. But I believe this is what I believe, and this is what Jesus was saying, is that children that are born of a family, in a Christian family, of where one of them is indeed a Christian, someone that has faith in Jesus Christ, that child is covered over with the covenant of God, the covenant of grace in the new covenant, until the time that child comes to faith in Christ Jesus. Where do I get that? The Bible says it in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. It says, for the unbelieving husband has been sanctified. The word sanctified means holy or separate, through his wife, and the unbelieving wife has been sanctified through her believing husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean. As it is, they are holy. And so there's some protection for the children of which the parents are in the faith. And there's an expectation that God's blessings would be upon these children, and that God would indeed regenerate them and bring them to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. What a delight it is. Boy, you guys have a lot of friends, and it's exciting that you've all come today and are here. Therefore, this morning, I am going to give these exhortations to Craig and Aaron Rakowski, the parents of Riley Renee Rakowski, and Eddie and Amanda Strubing, the parents of Emily Elizabeth Strubing. The most important duty that you have as parents is to teach your children the Word of God. We're going to be talking about that today in the sermon, and that you would read them Bible stories. I've still got a Bible my Ma read to us when we were kids. It's kind of fallen apart now. It had beautiful pictures, and I didn't really get religious, didn't go to church much, but who knows how much that the stories and the scripture that I was taught when I was a kid didn't bring me for faith in Christ when I was a young man. So teach them the Word of God. Then as they get older and they learn to read, that they can learn to read the rich treasures of the Word of God for themselves, and encourage them to do so, and to do so on a regular basis. That you would pray with them. You'd pray with them. Teach them to communicate with their Father in heaven, and help them to develop their own intimate relationship with them. And that when they come to the age that they understand what Christ has done for them, that you would lead them to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing that it is only through Him that they have possession of the righteousness of Christ and life eternal. And that lastly, that you would teach each of them to give themselves in loving service to the church of Christ, which is the body of Christ. You know, you can't separate the head from the body. That someday that they need to be taught that this church or whatever church they end up in is in fact the body of Christ, and they need to learn to love the brothers and sisters and serve. Let me give you a promise that is in the scriptures. The Bible says, for to you is the promise, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call unto him. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You will be saved. You and your house. Now, if you'll answer, I do, as I read these questions. Do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you claim God's covenant promises in their behalf? And do you look forward to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation as you do for your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before them a godly example, that you will pray with and for them, that you will teach them the doctrines of our holy faith, and that you will strive by all the means of God's empowerment to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Well, the congregation has a responsibility in this. It's interesting, if you look back at the Bible, you'll see that the family is not just the immediate physical family when a child is born into a Christian family. But the family is also extended to the whole community. the family of God that exists where the child and the family worships. So you do have a role. If you will please stand this morning and answer we do to this question. Do you as a congregation undertake the responsibility of assisting the parents in the Christian nurture of these children? Thank you. You may be seated. We will pray for each of the children as we dedicate them to the Lord. Each of the families, the parents have chosen a scripture specifically for this occasion and for their child. We'll begin with Eddie and Amanda Strubing, and then we will pray for Emily Elizabeth.
Okay, we have two verses. From 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory forever.
Proverbs 22:6, train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not turn from it.
Okay, praise the Lord. And that is your desire, I'm sure, for Emily and little Andrew up here. Could we pray for Emily? Oh, she's looking at that mic. You're going on this side. There you go. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful little girl. Lord, what a great work you have done as you've created and formed this child through your power, majesty, and grace. And I pray, Lord, that this child would grow up unto you and that the glory of your presence, the glory of your righteousness would be seen in her as she comes to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that you would protect her from evil, watch over her. I pray that you would give Eddie and Amanda great strength now as they raise their children. And Lord, that you would honor all the work that they do as they teach Emily the doctrines of the holy faith and teach her to love you and lead her to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for this little life. We thank you for the family. And now today at this moment, we dedicate her along with the parents to you. Father, watch over them. Give them great strength, love, and comfort. And may their household be a household that testifies to the greatness of your love and power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, Aaron and Craig, as we dedicate Riley, what verses have you chosen for them?
Well, we chose 8 verses, or just one psalm, Psalm 121. I lift my eyes up to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He watches over you, and he will not slumber. Indeed, he watches over Israel, will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over you. You are coming and going, both now and forevermore.
Yeah, what a great promise to receive by faith. Let's pray for little Riley. How old is she now?
Just over a month.
Uh-oh. She figured out I am not the mother. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this little life. Lord, newborn into the world. Lord, you have done such a fantastic job as you've knit her in your womb. Lord, we believe that you are the one that created her. Father, I pray for her that as she grows, you'd watch over her and protect her, that she would be healthy. And Lord, that as she grows and is taught the scriptures and taught to love you, Lord, that she would come to a place where she really understands the importance and the necessity of receiving Christ as her Lord and Savior. And Lord, as she grows then, that you would help her in her life reflect your image and your power and your greatness, that she would be and grow into to be a godly young woman. And I do pray for Craig and Aaron, new parents, and adjusting to what it means to be parents, Lord, that you would give them great grace and great strength. And Father, that in the example that they've already set in this congregation, that you would continue to take that example and encourage each of us as we witness their godly parenting. I pray that you would give them strength when time gets hard. Lord, that they would trust in you and look to you and not just to their own strength. And Father, that in every way that their family would honor you, the great Lord. And today, right now, at this time, I commit little Riley Renee to you. Father, take her into your arms. Bless her. and keep her as your child. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. She did good. Not yet. Nope. We're almost done. Let's pray. May the Lord bless and keep each of these families and their little ones. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now in the life everlasting and in the life everlasting. Amen. God bless both of you and all of you as you raise these children in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. Congratulations. Eddie and Amanda, a first Bible and a certificate. Congratulations. Thank you. Ooh. Last week, Tony introduced that we are going to be beginning a new series. And we have worked in this last about 9 months now, on some very difficult issues. And we have determined that at this time in the history of our church, we are going to go back to the basics of Christianity. And we're really going to be dealing with the issues of the Didache, the teaching that the Apostle Paul and the other apostles gave the churches to live on the basis of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I've compiled a list of 12 different things, and you're going to, in the next couple weeks, get a copy of those things in plastic, and you'll be able to put them on your refrigerator. But they're the things that I believe that are the most necessary, though sometimes simple and sometimes hard, for you to reflect and represent the life of Jesus Christ, both to your family, to your friends, neighbors, and to your community. And so today we're going to begin with one of those. It's not top on the list. I've chosen one specific one for this occasion. And this is the commitment. And if you take out your sermon notes, you should have in your bulletin sermon notes. And right at the bottom of the sermon notes is the challenge or the commitment. This is one of the 12 of the disciples' discipline that we are going to be dealing with today. And the challenge is, I will make personal devotions my regular practice. I will make personal devotions my regular practice. There's one thing to say, it is one thing to say that I love the Word of God, that the Word of God is important to me. But the issue comes down to very practical this. How important is it to me? Do I daily or regularly go to the Word of God and find the Word of God to be the strength of my life? Please take your Bibles and go with me to Colossians chapter 3, verse 16. Colossians chapter 3, verse 16. The didactic portion or the teaching portion of Colossians in relationship to lifestyle really begins in chapter 3. And Paul covers a specific organization of teaching both here in Colossians chapter 3 and 4 and in Ephesians 4, 5, and 6. Peter covers it throughout his letters, but it is absolutely true that the early disciples and apostles understood that there was a specific lifestyle that was to be associated with a person that named the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're in this series going to be weaving in and out of this section of Colossians and Ephesians, and then gathering in much of the rest of Scripture to help you really understand the disciples' discipline. How do we live out the relationship of Christ? First, let's look at Colossians 3, verse 16, just the first part of that, as we will cover the communal part of that at a later time. Paul writes to the Colossian church, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. Focusing on the first part, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Also, take your Bibles and go with me to the book of Psalms, the Psalms of David. Back to all the way to verse 1, chapter 1, verse 1. How is it that a person can live a life that is successful both in the church and in society as he goes about living out the gospel? Well, here it is in the book of Psalms, chapter 1, verse 1. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates. How often? Day and night. Day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does prospers. His delight is in the law of the Lord. We're going to bring this all together and talk about the importance of the Word of God. They were arguably the most important words ever spoken in relationship to Christianity in history. It was Martin Luther, and he spoke words that changed the world. It was a place, well, if you read it in the English, it's the Diet of Worms. And if you say it in German, it's more like the Diet of Worms. And Martin Luther was called forth by the authorities of the church and the government, and he was told he had to renounce what he was teaching, that he had to renounce what he was believing. And here was his answer: unless I am convicted by Scripture and plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils, for they have contradicted each other. My conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. God, help me. Here I stand. I cannot do otherwise. Well, what did he say? What was critical to his spiritual diet? He was not going to renounce the Word of God. He was not going to renounce it. And this probably was the turning point in history that moved the church back to an emphasis on the Scriptures and understanding the true redemption that we have in Jesus Christ. But you know what? It would have faded away except for another event that happened some years later. There was a place called Augsburg. And at Augsburg, all the princes of Germany were called by Emperor Charles to come together, and he was going to command them to renounce the newfound faith, and he was going to destroy whatever he could. And they came to Augsburg to present a confession called the Augsburg Confession of what they believe. Charles commanded them to command their preachers to stop preaching the Word of God. And he told them they must give up their Bibles. And as the movie represents, the late movie about Dr. Luther, Martin Luther, is that the princes came forward and they bowed before the emperor and they said, "We will not stop our preachers from preaching the Word of God. We will not give up our Bibles. Before we do so, we will bow before you and let you take our heads." How about you today? How important is the Word of God to you? What if someone came to you and said, "I want you to give up your Bible"? What would you say? "Well, I got to find it first. I haven't read it in quite a while. I'll dust it off." What would your response be? How important is the Word of God to your spiritual diet? I was talking to a priest one time, and I said, "What's important to you in your faith? What is your faith really center around? He said, "Well, it centers around the Mass, the Lord's Supper." And I suppose if you asked a Muslim today, what is your faith center around? He might say the Quran or Mecca, as I prayed to the east. But what about an evangelical Christian today? What is your faith center around? What is central in your life? I want to tell you today, it must be, it has to be, in this fading culture, the Word of the living God. What did Jesus say? Man shall not live by what? Bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. There are so many books today written about your physical diet. We worry so much about how we look and how we take care of ourselves, but how are you doing in your spiritual diet? What is the answer to us today that struggle with our devotions? You know, I'm not here to tell you exactly what you have to do or how you must organize your own devotions, whether it should be morning or night, whether you should rise up at 3 a.m. or read the Bible right before you go to bed. But I'm going to encourage you to do this, that as often as you can, you need to be in the Word of God. And as you're in the Word of God, you need to be asking your Heavenly Father to communicate to you the truths of the Holy Scripture. And if you do not, I do not believe that the Word of God is that important to you today. What is the answer to doing our devotions? I believe the old Nike slogan said it the best. Just do it. Just do it. And there is no other answer. You've got to come to the place in your life where you say, the Word of God is the most important thing to me, because it is through the Word of God that the Holy Spirit takes the mind of God and reveals to me His will for my life. Well, let's talk about what you should do with it as you make personal devotions your regular practice. Number one in your outline, you should read it. You should read it. Sounds simple, but you need to read it. It says in verse 2 of Psalms 1, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. It's important to him. And what do you do? You got to read it. You say, well, I'm not a reader. I don't like to read. I'll tell you what, I didn't either before I came to be a Christian. I didn't like to read and didn't read very much of anything. But you will not grow in the faith until you work hard at reading and understanding the Word of God. I began reading the Word of God when I was 21 years old, and I had just gotten married a couple years before and was having my first child. And just as these young couples were up here, and I'm sure they've thought about it too, is what am I going to teach this child about life? They've already dedicated their lives to Christ. I hadn't, so I began to read the Scriptures. I said, I've got to figure out what truth is. And I read the Scriptures for over 6 months and came to a place in my life where I understood this book, the Word of God, to be absolutely the truth. And I came to a place where I had faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and His work. But I had to read it. Well, you're not going to get it any other way. Well, today they have tapes and CDs, and I suppose that's good too. But it's hard to underline and circle and meditate on words coming from a disc. Well, we need to read it, and we read it because we believe it's valuable to us. The way of righteousness, if you look in verse 3, comes by reading the Scriptures. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does prospers. And look down at verse 6. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. I want you also to understand this morning that there is only two paths that the Scripture presents in this psalm. It's not that there's one on one side who delights and loves and meditates on the Word of God, then there's one on this side that ignores the Word of God. There's nothing in the middle. There's nothing in the middle. You're either on one side or the other. That's what the Scripture says. You will be blessed, the Bible says. You will experience the righteousness of Christ if, in fact, you come to know His Word. I think a lot of Christians today don't understand that you cannot love Christ without loving His Word. You can't separate a word from a person. If someone came up to you and said, you know what, I think you're ugly, I think you're stupid, I do not like you, and then went away and 5 minutes later came back and said, you know, you're really a nice guy. I said, well, you know what, that's not what you said 5 minutes ago. And the person said, well, that was just my words. See, your words and the person are come together. You want to experience a full revelation and experiencing Christ in your life, it comes through meditation upon the Word of God. We need to read it. We read what's valuable to us. How many here read the newspaper? Why do you read the newspaper? Because it's valuable to you. You want to know the information. Speaking of a newspaper, there was in a column in a newspaper where you'd write in and express your opinions about things. A man wrote this. It was about churches. And he said, I quit going to church this year. I decided that listening to sermons week after week was a stupid thing to do. After all, I went to church for more than 40 years. And during my lifetime, I probably heard 5,000 sermons. I can only remember about 5 of them. What a waste of time. Well, this sparked a fury of letter writing as people wrote in and said all types of different things. Some agreed and some different. But one letter came in, and after this letter came in, no one else wrote in. Here's what the person said. I quit eating this year thanks to Bored and Busy's insights. I decided that eating week after week was a stupid thing to do. After all, I've probably eaten more than 40 years, and during my lifetime, I probably have eaten 5,000 meals. I can only remember about 5 of them. What a waste of time. And he signs it, starved and stupid. It's the same way with God's Word, though. A steady diet feeds and transforms the soul. And you might not remember everything you hear in a sermon about the Word of God. You might not remember every word that you read out of the Word of God, but what you're doing is you're taking the Word of God and you're putting it between your two ears so that the Holy Spirit has the ability to take what God knows and use it and apply it to, in your life in specific situations as He brings it back to your memory. How often should you read it? Well, it says here in Psalms, day and night. Take your Bibles and let's go to a New Testament passage. Go to Acts chapter 17. As Luke records the travels of the Apostle Paul, and he comes into a place called Berea. And he contrasts the Bereans with others that they had given the Word of God to, comparing them to the Thessalonians. Go to Acts chapter 17, and we're going to read in verse 10. As soon as it was night, the brothers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. And on arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures. How often? Every day. Every day to see if what Paul said was true. I think it's important for you to have a regular practice of devotions. I don't think it's good enough to say, well, I go to church on Sunday, I listen to such and such program on television or on the radio or this CD or that CD. I think you need to take the Bible in your hand and sit down in some quiet time before the Lord, no matter how short, and pray the words of Scripture into your life. You pray the words of Scripture into your life. Why is it that we go year after year after year in the church and we do not change? It's because we do not take the Word of God seriously. Even if we do read it, we just read it and we go our way and we forget what it says. Now I know that's true because I've done it many, many times in my life. I have a little devotional book that I use, and I used it for about 5 or 6 years recently, up till about 2 months ago. And I stopped using it because I wanted to do something else. And I discovered very quickly that I didn't do my devotions as well as when I used some type of a guide. And so I would use this guide. But once in a while, often even on Sundays, I wouldn't do my devotions. And then I'd try to make it up on Monday. And I would hurry through my devotions and do all the check marks of all the scripture. So my devotional book looked very impressive. But I would go my way and I had no idea what I just read. I'd forget it. See, that's not the idea. That's not what you're supposed to do. It's got to go beyond that. When you study Scripture, you've got to get to a place where you do what it says in the second part of your notes. You should meditate on it. You should meditate on it. What does it say in Psalms chapter 2? And on His law, He meditates day and night. You need to meditate on it. Some people here might say, well, you know, I don't have good reading comprehension. A lot of people have that problem. Well, the Word of God is not meant to be skim read. You're not to take it and just read it fast as you can. The Word of God is meant for you to take it, to read it slowly, and to ask the Lord while you're reading it, Lord, what do you want to share with me this morning? What do you want to teach me this morning? What do you want to show me about my life this morning? And then to go into the Word of God and spend time memorizing it and meditating on it. I wonder how many of us today could finish the second half of a Bible verse if we would give you the first half. There was a story about a first grade teacher, and she gave some popular proverbs to her class, and she asked the class of first graders to finish these popular proverbs. These aren't all from the Scripture. These are just popular proverbs. And here's what they said. It's kind of cute. Better to be safe than punch a fifth grader. Strike while the bug is close. Don't bite the hand that looks dirty. You can't teach an old dog arithmetic. If you lie down with dogs, you stink in the morning. An idle mind, and this is for Laura Harwood, an idle mind is a good way to go to sleep. Where there's smoke, there's lung cancer. A penny saved is not very much. Children should be seen and not spanked. And if at first you don't succeed, get new batteries. But would you do better with the Bible today? Would you do better with the Bible? I know that in the New Hope Church picnics, year after year, they would have the Bible trivia contest. And I could just never beat Amy Flader. And they would do that. But God wants us to know the Word of God. And not just to know it, but to spend time meditating on it. And then you take what it says and you pray it into your life. Otherwise, it'll do you no good. The check marks mean absolutely nothing. We meditate on it. The Hebrew word for meditate is literally to murmur. To murmur, like a cow chewing his cud over and over and over. Now, we got this thing going at our work. Me and my brother run a company. And I don't know why this has happened, but I think as you get older, you start doing more murmuring. You ever seen an old man following his wife along in the store? And I don't know why my brother talks to himself, but I know why I talk to myself. So I start thinking about what I'm going to preach on. And I'm walking around, and I'm thinking about what I'm going to be saying to the congregation on Sunday morning. But then, unfortunately, I forget that other people are around. They start talking out loud. But see, that's what the idea in the Hebrew word for meditation is all about. That's not something that you just look at, think about, and forget. It's something that you repeat to yourself and you repeat to yourself until you can understand the greatest dimensions of application in all of your experiences of life. That means you take one verse, it could last you a week. Or longer. But use up the Word of God within your life. Colossians 3:16, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly. That's what it's talking about. Go to John chapter 15. This is the passage where Jesus talks about being the vine. And he's the vine, and we're the branches, and the Father's doing all of His work in our life. And I was dealing with this with the men at the retreat yesterday, and talking about that it is the goal of the spiritual life to produce much fruit. And if you're here today and you're a Christian, it's the goal of your spiritual life to produce much fruit, much fruit. And how do you do that? Look at John chapter 15, verse 7. Jesus said, if you remain in me and my what? Words remain in you. And that word remain, by the way, if you probably have a King James, it probably says abide, doesn't it? Abide. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, and it comes from the Greek word that means house or dwelling. In other words, they are to be living there. If you are living in Christ and his words are living in you, you know what that means? You're not just stopping in for a visit. They're staying there, living there, not leaving. Ask whatever you wish and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit. That only happens when you allow the Word of God to dwell and to live within your life. Also go to John chapter 17, verse 17. Jesus said of the disciples in his high priestly prayer, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. What does sanctification mean? To make holy, to make into the image of Jesus Christ. How will that happen? Through the Word of God. Through the Word of God, and only through the Word of God. And some people say, well, why don't we talk more about prayer? Well, you need to pray when you read the Word of God. Prayer and the Word of God go together. In prayer, we communicate to our Father, and in the Word, he communicates back to us. And then we continue to pray until what God says is a reality in our life. You need to read it. You need to meditate on it. Lastly, you need to obey it. You need to obey it. Go back to Psalms again. Psalms chapter 1. Verse 3. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. You have to move from meditation, from reading and meditation, to obedience. Because if you're not obedient, then you're not going to discover the rich treasures that God has placed right in front of you. You have to decide before you go to the Word of God that you're going to obey what it says. That when God's voice speaks to you as you read the Bible, you say to the Father, you say, Lord, I know that's you. This is your word. You've spoken it into my life. And I am not going to hesitate to obey it. You don't say, you know, that's an interesting thought. I've learned something new today. I'll think about it for a while. And maybe next week I'll consider what it means in my life. No, we need to get to a place where we hear God speak in his word and we say to God, today I'm going to do what you call me to do. And it's only that attitude and through that attitude that we are going to be blessed. Prospering comes from obedience. Freedom from sin comes from obedience. Experiencing God's power and presence comes from obedience. Let's at least look up that scripture there. Go to back to the Gospel of John again. Go to the Gospel of John chapter 14. Let's read verse 23. Jesus replied, if anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. And my Father will love him. And it just literally means to have rich, deep, and experience rich, deep fellowship in the love of the Father. And will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me will not obey my teachings. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. If anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. You know, words are cheap. Words are cheap. People all the time make promises and say they're going to do this or they're going to do that. But when it comes to the Word of God, God's not fooled. You want to be blessed in your life. You want to understand the righteousness of God. Do you want to understand what Christ can do in and through you in His strength and in His power? You want to experience the riches of God's grace and strength in your life. There's only one way to do it, is to go to the Word of God. Let the Word of God dwell in you richly. Let the Word of God abide in you. Read it. Memorize and meditate on it. Apply it to your life in obedience. Because if you are not doing that today, I do not believe that you're remaining true to the trust of the evangelical church, which began when Martin Luther spoke those words. And greater yet, that I believe that if you do not take the Word of God seriously, you are not taking Christ Himself seriously. Will you today make a commitment to God to make devotions your regular practice? And will you demonstrate the love of Christ, reading it, meditating on it, and obeying it, bringing it into your life to be a representative of the King, that you may impact your friends, neighbors, and family with the Word of God? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time together. Thank you for all the guests and visitors that have come. Lord, I pray that you would speak to their lives, that they would begin a regular practice, a discipline of spending time in your Word. Not only would they read it, Lord, but that they would meditate on it, that they would obey it, and do so in every dimension of their lives. Lord, that you would transform me and transform your people. Sanctify us through your Word, that we might reflect your image to this church and to this culture. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's all stand and we'll sing our response, please.
To me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see. Wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty. Teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words. Sing them over. to me. Wonderful words of life, let me more of their beauty see. Wonderful words of life, words of life and beauty, teach me faith and